Wow, thank you, Ken. Good morning, St. Luke's.
Good morning.
I am Reverend Michelle Kaminsky, and it's good to be here.
It's great.
It is great to be here because this is where we come to renew our spirits and get refreshed for the week ahead with our worship series, Redefining Success, which is based on Dr. Wayne Dyer's book, 10 Secrets for Success and Inner Peace. Last week, we started the series, and we learned the first secret, which is to have a mind that is open to everything and attached to nothing. And today we will learn the second secret, which is don't die with your music still in you. So I invite you to sit back and relax, for you are welcome, loved, and accepted just as you are. If you are here with us for the very first time, we welcome you. We ask you to grab a purple bag on your way out the door. You'll see them sitting there. Has more information about St. Luke's and a little treat for you as well. If everyone will take a moment and sign the friendship pad, that's the black folder that's sitting in each row. And if you're watching online, we ask that you sign the virtual friendship pad. While you're doing that, we have announcements about some of the things that are going on in our community right now.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Reverend Liza, and super excited to tell you that the doors of the Fellowship Hall are closed today because there's really a high-level art installation on the other side of the wall. This is art from our preschoolers, and you will be so impressed. So I hope that after the service, you make time to walk through and see all of their amazing art throughout the year. The kind of the best flow would be to start in the door from the hallway, which will then the first thing you'll see is actually art by our own staff, with a little guessing game involved. So check that out. And don't worry, there are donuts, and there is coffee this morning. tomorrow is the day that Vacation Bible School registration begins at 3 p.m., I think. So please make sure that you put that in your calendars and that you get all your young people signed up for this amazing week, and that you, as adults, make sure that you're ready to volunteer and make this an amazing event. We typically have hundreds of kids who are here with us that week. A couple of our learning group classes are starting up this week today. Sam and Cassie are starting their class talking about the 10 Secrets of Success from Wayne Dyer. That's at 11 today. And then tomorrow night, the Excavating Jesus class begins. CSE has many things coming up, but two I wanted to mention specifically are a trip to the Colorado History Museum and an outdoor adventure hike at Spruce Mountain. We're just days away from our annual day of service. Very excited to have many people participate in that this year. There are a few spots left, particularly doing backcountry cleanup and going to Florence Crittenden services. You can sign up online. And then we want you to make sure that you have these dates on your calendar for family camp in July and this all-church mountain retreat up at Camp Buckhorn over Memorial Day weekend. If you have any questions or want to make sure that you are signed up for these events, please reach out either to myself or Caroline Merchant. And then the General Conference of the United Methodist Church is coming up, and we are holding two sessions so that everyone can sort of learn about what is happening. We're doing a pre-session and a post-session. So we're starting next Sunday at 6:30 p.m. with a dessert potluck, because we are United Methodist. And so this will be kind of an overview of where we are and how we got to where we are. And then we'll do a post-session in May. And so those will be led by myself and Susan McIntosh and Monty Hoffman. And then last but not least, a quick save the date for an amazing concert on May 5th, where all of our music and arts ensembles will perform a wonderful concert, the Prism Concert.
Great. So many things happening here at St. Luke's that change our lives and change the lives of others, because our mission is to reflect God's love, deepen people's connection to Christ, and show compassion to all in ways that change lives. Thank you for the way that you help us do that. And so now I invite you to stand and reflect that love with each other as you greet each other and pass the peace of Christ.
Thank you. My name is Manuel Rodriguez, and I'll be reading today's scripture. Today I'll be reading Psalm chapter 57, verses 7 to 11. My heart is unwavering. God, my heart is unwavering. I will sing and make music. Wake up, my glory. Wake up, harp and lyre. I will wake the dawn itself. I will give thanks to you, my Lord, among all the peoples. I will make music to you among the nations, because your faithful love is as high as heaven. Your faithfulness reaches the clouds. Exalt yourself, God, higher than heaven. Let your glory be all over earth. Now I'd like to invite Anna Fisher for children's time.
Good morning. I'd like to ask the children to come up for children's time. All right, so our scripture today was a psalm. Does anyone know what that is? Maybe. It's like a song or a poem. Who likes art? What kind of art is your favorite art? Watercolor? Drawing? What about you? Nice. Yes, I love painting and coloring too. It's super fun. We also love picking flowers and putting them together in beautiful bouquets. Have you guys ever picked flowers for somebody and arranged them and put them in a vase? Anybody ever pick flowers? Yeah. Oh, yeah? What kind of flowers? All sorts of flowers? Yeah. So why do we pick flowers for people? Maybe because we love them? And because they're pretty, yeah. So we give flowers to people because they're pretty and it shows our love for them. And that's why God created the earth and God created pretty flowers and all the pretty nature, because he wanted to show us love. And this is my favorite time of year because there's flowers all over the earth and art all over the earth. One of the ways that we can give our love back to God is by creating art ourselves. So one of the kings of Israel, David, he wrote a whole book of songs, like biblical scripture of songs, to express how he talks to God and how he thanks God for all the beautiful things that he created for us. So just remember that when you are singing songs, when you're coloring, when you're making things out of clay, that's how you worship God and how you thank him for all the beautiful things on earth. So now we're going to do a repeat after me prayer. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for all the beautiful flowers on earth. And thank you for allowing us to show our creativity through art. Thank you for creating the whole earth for us. Thank you for loving us. We love you. Amen.
Lift up your voice and with us sing, Hallelujah.
Wow. Thank you so much, Chancel Choir, Ken and Jim. As I light our compassion candle today, I ask that you send your love, prayers, and compassion to the Middle East. I'm going to light the candle for the strikes on Israel, that ongoing conflict. Everyone who is affected, they need our love, compassion, and prayers. Let us send it now. Now take a deep breath. This is your moment with just you and God. Close your eyes if that feels good and right to you. And silently begin to list the things that didn't go well this week. Things that felt difficult or made you feel sad. And now I invite you to review your week again, this time silently sharing with God all the things that did go well, the things that made you smile, the things that brought you joy. God of symphonies and surprises. Music fills our ears and our souls with beauty and healing. It lends a hand when we can't put words to how we are feeling, bringing forth our joy, sorrow, and gratitude. So what music are you playing in us, Lord? Let us attune our ears to you, so we can hear the song you have been playing within us since day one. For these are the notes, the tunes, and the rhythms that will help us become all you dream for us to be. And these are the melodies that we were meant to play for the world, so they can benefit us and others. And for those in our world who don't hear a song playing, or who are denied living to the beat of their own drum, we ask that you pour a special blessing upon them. Fill their hearts with hope and fill us with ways to help. For success in life is not just an individual undertaking, it is a communal effort that necessitates success for everyone, so all of creation can live in harmony. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, whose love resonates through this earth, we lift our voices together as one as we pray the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Sustainer, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hallelujah.
You guys, you didn't tell me about the stripes that I was supposed to be wearing. And that Lord of the Dance moment. My gosh, amazing. Our second scripture reading this morning is from the letter that Paul wrote to the church in Philippi from Philippians 4, 6 through 9. He wrote to them, "Don't be anxious about anything. Rather, bring up all of your requests to God in your prayers and petitions, along with giving thanks. Then the peace of God that exceeds all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. From now on, brothers and sisters, if anything is excellent and if anything is admirable, focus your thoughts on these things. All that is true, all that is holy, all that is just, all that is pure, all that is lovely, and all that is worthy of praise. Practice these things. Whatever you learned, received, heard, or saw in us, and the God of peace will be with you." Amen. For years and years, obviously when I'm not listening to the music from the worship band, my usual go-to spiritual music has been the recordings of a group called Page CXVI. It's kind of wordy. They've recorded familiar hymns and then made them a little bit more modern, a little bit more up-to-date. Some of the hymns are a little faster. Some of them are slower. Their version of Be Still My Soul is like simple and lovely, very moving. Their version of Come Thou Font is lovely. It's like one of my favorites. Their version of Christ the Lord is Risen Today is what I had set for my alarm at 4:30 on Easter morning. And you might have heard me say that it didn't really quite get me in the Easter mood. It wasn't until I heard our chancel choir singing it that I really felt Easter had arrived. Those words, though, by the way, of that hymn were written by Charles Wesley, brother of John Wesley, in 1739, and they're really beautifully poetic lyrics. The first stanza goes, "Heaven and earth in chorus say, raise your joys and triumphs high, sing, all heavens, and the earth replies." Thank you for that assist. You're getting all your alleluias in today, by the way. Alleluia indeed. Because the risen Christ walks with us, and we are reminded over and over and over again that we are part of something grand as Easter people, called to live and experience and share the good news of redemption from what was broken and lost, from resurrection and into abundant life, and to find resilient hope when despair otherwise surrounds us. It is this very good news that causes all of earth and heaven to sing together. And have you ever thought about what hearing the heavens and the earth singing out would really sound like? Have you heard it? Have you felt it? This band I mentioned, Page CXVI, is special to me partly because of the meaning of their name. If you translate the Roman numerals in their name, the number is 116. Page 116 is a reference to the page in the edition of The Magician's Nephew, the first book in the Chronicles of Narnia by C.S. Lewis. The Magician's Nephew is the prequel to The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and it is in The Magician's Nephew that we understand the events that lead to the creation of the world of Narnia. And it is on page 116 that the lion Aslan creates and sings creation into existence. The narrative is kind of focused on a young boy named Diggory. And the narrative says, in the darkness, something was happening. A voice had begun to sing. It was very far away, and Diggory found it hard to decide from what direction it was coming. Sometimes it seemed to come from all directions at once. Sometimes he almost thought it was coming out of the earth beneath them. Its lower notes were deep enough to be the voice of the earth herself. And this section of text ends to say, there were no words, there was hardly even a tune, but it was, beyond comparison, the most beautiful noise he had ever heard. It was so beautiful, he could hardly bear it. And a few pages later, this description goes on, that as the singing voice continues, the mountains lift up from the earth, the sun begins to rise up in the east, and he describes the one voice singing when the empty sky is suddenly filled with thousands of shining points of light. And he said, if you had seen it and heard it, you would have felt quite certain that it was the stars themselves which were singing, and that it was the first voice, the deep one, which had made them appear and made them sing. I know that these books that are primarily for children are works of fiction, but they are also a powerful allegorical story of our Judeo-Christian faith. Aslan, the lion, is understood here to be present, involved, and the one who wills creation into existence. Later, in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, Aslan answers a call to sacrifice himself to pay for the betrayal of another, and yet he is redeemed and restored to life. And these writings are fictional allegory, but nonetheless, they speak to our lives of faith, because we recognize in them glimpses of our own creation narrative in our sacred text and our understanding of the sacrificial death and resurrection of Christ. As Aslan sings creation into existence, we remember that we live in a world united with all creation as ones who have been created by the one who calls us into harmony with one another, as we share our own unique song. What is the song and the story that your own life sings? What is it that you have in you that bubbles up and bursts with excitement because it needs to be shared? What are the verses that ebb and flow tied together with the foundation of a refrain, the chorus that guides your song back to the consistent themes of your life? I wonder if we don't all hear that song at times in our lives. We long to sing it, but then we brush it off because we have to make a living. We have to ensure success. We have to do kind of what everyone else thinks we should be doing. And it's apparent to me that conversations about success are most productive when paired with a strong understanding of vocation. Theologian Frederick Buchner said, "Your vocation in life comes from where your greatest joy meets the world's biggest need." And I was lucky enough to, during my undergraduate career, spend a lot of time in seminars and workshops that really focused on what our vocation was going to be, not just a career, but a vocation, which was really helpful to me because when I started undergrad in 2002, I kind of half-heartedly started coursework to focus on elementary education. And right away, I spent some time doing a clinical in a kindergarten classroom, which was excellent because I realized soon that was not actually the right path for me. And then I hung out in the art department for a while, in studio arts, especially ceramics and pottery. Another time, I'll tell you about this ceramics conference I went to in Indianapolis. I also took a lot of art history classes. I took a bunch of English lit and writing classes. I really was into sociology for a while, and then also anthropology, a little bit of poli-sci. All to say, I really took advantage of my liberal arts degree, which is the whole point, honestly. But then I got back from my semester in Scotland, and all of my friends were gearing up for senior year, declaring their majors, making sure they had all the prerequisites for grad school, and I started to get a little anxious. I looked at my transcript, sat down with my advisor, and no surprise to anyone, I had taken a religious studies class pretty much every semester and already had the credits for a major in religion. The song that I kept singing, the music that filled my soul, wove around and around and led me back over and over again to the study of religion. It's the same tune, the same song that was singing and kept me coming back again to this path of church leadership and ordained ministry and life in the local church. In the letter that Paul wrote to the Philippians, we hear words of encouragement and hope. He's writing to say how much he loves and cares for those people. He's writing to tell them they are doing good work in a difficult time. And part of his encouragement, I think, is a specific invitation to focus on what is good and true, the things that are right and noble and authentic. It's clear that this letter is addressing that even though there is a lot to worry about and there is stress in the community, just like there is in our world today, Paul is reminding this young faith community that worry and anxiety without action is just going to be a dead end over and over. Instead, what does it look like when we, as Paul says, put into practice what we learned and heard and know to be true? Paul seems to indicate that when we trust God, and very importantly, trust ourselves, we allow for God to use us and our unique skills and abilities and to put them to use in a way that only we can. Wayne Dyer refers to a similar concept when he writes that we all have music inside us that is longing to be heard. Our unique song is whatever it is in life that makes us come alive. I think as we get older or as life deals us criticism and critique, it gets harder to trust ourselves, to let go, and to just let that music sing. I think at those times, it's important to always look at the children in our lives and the way that they respond to music. When Hazel was about 6 months old and had just mastered sitting up, I looked over at her and observed that the way that she was bouncing in her seat and bobbing her head was exactly in time to the beat of the music that was playing on the radio. And as a new mom, my first thought was, babies are so cool. And my second thought, of course, was, wait a second, is my baby exceptional? Yes. Okay, the answer is yes. I don't know where he is, but we have come to conclude that that was exceptional for a six-month-old at the time. And as Hazel has grown, she has always heard and felt and then expressed music in a deeply felt way. At 6 months old, she felt music in her soul that could not be contained. And she still can't contain it. She thinks best while she is also singing loudly at the same time, which does not really go well for her in math class. But it is my experience that when we are in tune with God, when we are in tune with ourselves and listening to our souls, taking care of our health, making time for fun, this is when I am most able to remember the tune of the song that only I can sing. the song that I was created to share and to share loudly. There are those moments when I am most alive. One of my great mentors, not really directly, but I just love his work, Howard Thurman, said, "Don't ask what the world needs of you. Ask what makes you come alive and then go do it. Because what the world needs is people who have come alive." The music of your soul is the unique song that only you can sing. It is the song that brings us all life. And I believe to my core that when any of us, as children of God, created in the image of the divine, find what it is that makes us come alive, when we are true and honest about who we are and what we have to give, the heavens and the earth shout out. The heavens and all the earth sing together as God sings and dances in joy and celebration, hearing the song that we were each called to sing. Shout it out, my friends. Alleluia. Amen.
Music singing out here at St. Luke's, don't we? I love it. Thank you so much, Ed and choir. That was wonderful, and our worship band earlier. As we come into our giving back to God, we give back in so many different ways. We are so grateful to have had the blessings of the way Bob Ferguson, one of our pillars of our faith community here at St. Luke's that helped bring St. Luke's into being. We learned yesterday at his memorial service, the family had a small intimate service for him, that he was very instrumental in getting the bank loan when it looked like St. Luke's wasn't going to come into fruition. He not only helped secure that, but he also donated a large portion of the money that was held secret until his death. So we will add that to our history here at St. Luke's. It was very important to understand that and have that secret revealed. And I also want to let you know that we succeeded so well in our Lenten mission project and all the collections that we did. Look at all those diapers. We had 3,100 diapers collected for the Florence Crittenden services, and over 100 pounds of toiletries collected for newly arriving immigrants. Thank you, St. Luke's, for the ways you help us give back. It is also your giving dollars that help us do all that we are doing here. So thank you so much. As the ushers come forward, will you join me in our offertory prayer? In response to the love you have given us, God, we offer here what we have, what we do, and even more, who we are, for the sake of all people. Amen. Before we end our service, I would like to invite our staff parish relations co-chairs, Judy Weiler and Jan Ballard, forward for an announcement for us this morning.
Good morning. I want to read a letter to you from our district superintendent, Chris Carr. and he is with the Mountain Sky Conference of the United Methodist Church, and this is regarding the appointment of our new senior pastor. Dear family in Christ, grace and peace to you. I am writing to share that Bishop Karen Oliveto intends to appoint the Reverend Caleb Rundell as lead minister of St. Luke's United Methodist Church in Highlands Ranch, effective July 1st, 2024. Bishop Oliveto also intends to renew the appointments of Reverends Liza Stoltz Hanson and Sally Subi Long to St. Luke's. Pastor Rundell is currently serving the people of Fruta, Colorado, with Fruta United Methodist Church, and as the Congregational Resource Minister for the Utah Western Colorado District. Please pray for God to bless Pastor Rundell and both congregations during this time of transition. May gifts of grace be realized by all involved. I pray the Holy Spirit will enliven you all in your growth as disciples of Jesus Christ through a deepened faith, enhanced congregational vitality, and committed missional presence in your community. In Christ's peace, Chris Carr.
And now as the other Silver Sister, I'd like to share just a little bit of information about Reverend Caleb. On April the 9th, SPRT was met with him, and we had our introductory meeting. He answered our questions honestly and openly. He's a very good communicator. We were very impressed with his desire for teamwork, especially with Pastor Liza and Pastor Sally. He comes to us as a farm boy. He grew up in Lamar on a ranch, so he's no stranger to hard work. He'll have plenty of it here. In addition, he told us that he wanted to be a pastor from the age 16 on. He pursued his studies, graduated from CU, and then up in 2012, graduated from ILF. Along the way, he did have a number of different jobs. One that might be of interest to all of us is he is a veteran. He served with the Colorado National Guard in Iraq. And he also has a number of other skills that I'm sure we'll learn about over time. Reverend Caleb has served churches on the eastern part of Colorado as well as the western part, with 4 years at Father Dyer Methodist Church in Breckenridge. He looks forward to getting to know us and working with our staff and congregation to implement our vision for the future. So, first week of July, folks, let's welcome him to our church and our St. Luke's family. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Oh, back here. St. Luke's, all three current clergy, myself, Reverend Liza, and Reverend Sally, fully support the appointment of Reverend Caleb Rundell as lead minister of St. Luke's United Methodist Church, and we are all so delighted that the bishop intends to reappoint Reverend Sally and Reverend Liza here at St. Luke's.
Yes, I know along with all of you, I have spent a lot of time thinking of every possible configuration or potential for what the future clergy configuration would be like at St. Luke's. When I heard Caleb's name, I was shocked and so thrilled. We've known Caleb for years. Denton and Caleb sang together in a worship band at a conference event. He was a chaplain for the Board of Ordained Ministry, so was by my side through the whole ordination process. You're going to love him. He is fun and energetic, and I think we are all going to have a lot of fun together. And most importantly, I could not be more thrilled to know that I'll be serving another year at St. Luke's. I feel so strongly that my song is not done here at St. Luke's. Although I do not literally sing, you know what I mean.
Yay, thank you. As we lean into this clergy transition, I ask for your prayers for St. Luke's and for Fruita United Methodist Church, the church where Reverend Caleb is currently serving. And in preparation of this transition, we will need to have a charge conference to approve the new clergy salaries. That charge conference is scheduled for our exec team members on Wednesday, April 24th at 6:15 p.m. All exec team members are encouraged to attend and are also encouraged to join us in the chapel right after this service. Exec team is going to get a sneak peek preview of the Futures Task Force report, which will then be presented to our entire community on April 28th at the end of worship. So we're excited about that. St. Luke's, there is a song within this community that is going to sing out even louder and is going to sing out even stronger. What a blessing to have the clergy team of Reverend Caleb, Reverend Liza, and Reverend Sally join forward with you in helping you sing your song to the world. And now let us sing the song that defines us, Micah 6:8, as we stand and sing our song benediction.
What does the Lord require of you?
And now let us go beyond these walls with grace, courage, and wonder and sing love into every soul. It's going to be a great future, and it's going to be a great week. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.